Hello, my name is Risto Laanoja. I'm architect in Alphabuild. And my responsibility specifically is consensus. And this talk is about consensus in Alphabuild. First, we start with a background. What is consensus? So briefly, it's obvious we have a set of parties and we need to reach agreement about something. And this something can be a validity of transactions. It can be order of transactions, in which order we execute them. It can be content of a bucket, what kind of things we have there, and everybody must agree on the content. And first, let's define what is ledger consensus. So ledger consensus is also known as Nakamoto consensus, and this is a blockchain-specific thing. Basically, it means that if you have a set of nodes who collectively build a blockchain, then those nodes need to reach agreement about blockchain content. And this ledger consensus is defined as two properties. First is consistency. It means that all the rest of the world sees exactly the same content inside this blockchain. And the second property is liveness, meaning that the progress is made, eventually new blocks get added. It's quite trivial. And second definition is this more, let's say, scientific. It's related to distributed systems theory, which is a specific field in computer science and pretty well researched during last 50 plus years. But this consensus in distributed systems theory is defined through properties which distributed algorithm must satisfy. So most important of them is definitely agreement. It means that no two correct nodes reach to a different result. And if you have more results, and we have more correct nodes, then we all need to share exactly the same result. And the correct is somewhat fuzzy thing, and lots of depend on how we define this word of correctness. And also we have some more trivial properties which this algorithm must satisfy via validity. Meaning that basically it means that the nodes should not provide some kind of like stupid answers. They have to be based on actual inputs. Integrity, so not so blah blah too much. And termination, meaning that the nodes shouldn't think for too long to participate successfully in this algorithm. So this is pretty low-level thing, and let's say this ledger consensus is somewhat bigger, and we can build a ledger consensus based on this low-level BFT consensus, for example. So it's like a component which we use to build bigger systems. And a bit about this fuzzy word, correctness. And this is basic assumption, what we assume about the system, how system can fail. And also, it depends on what kind of things a potential attacker can do, what can go wrong. And in order to provide a good algorithm, we have to prove its security and other properties. And of course, in order to prove something, we need to have a well-defined set of assumptions. So first, let's look at how this what goes wrong can be defined. And here we have like two most important classes. One is so-called fail-stop model, where a node or computer, if it fails, it just disappears. It goes out of network, it stops responding to queries. But it means that if a node fails, then it doesn't do anything strange. So it cannot, let's say, continue executing a protocol, but with some modifications, perhaps in order to attack something. And then second class, what kind of like problems we can assume is a so-called Byzantine fault-tolerant model, where nodes can fail arbitrarily, meaning that they are allowed to do absolutely anything. They can execute intelligent coordinated attacks against other nodes. They can introduce some well-hidden bit corruptions in a system. So basically, they can be sneakily doing absolutely anything what they want. But still, the entire system must be secure, given we have a certain ratio of Byzantine nodes. Byzantine here means that node which have failed Byzantinely, meaning that the node which basically is compromised. And a bit of more assumptions, we assume that digital signatures exist. This is a standard assumption. And we also assume that authenticated data links are available. They are quite realistic assumptions, and having digital signatures makes building Byzantine fault-tolerant protocols much easier. Basically, the signed message works as a proof of somebody have said something. So they can be forwarded to each other by other trusted or non-Byzantine nodes to figure out who is wrong, or if we have so-called equivocation, meaning that one node tells one thing to part of the nodes and different thing to different part of the nodes, trying to corrupt something. And also, this kind of signed messages can be served as a proof of just a node being wrong or malicious. In like Ledger consensus, there is a like very useful tool which can be used after the fact of something failing or something going wrong, which is so-called fraud proofs. Other nodes collect signed conflicting messages from some other nodes. And this is, can be a basis of so-called slashing, where staked funds are taken away from participants. So digital signatures are like very, very useful tool. And when we are talking about like basic assumptions, the assumptions about environment are also like extremely important. And with timing, we have a model called so-called synchronous model. It means that all messages within system are delivered within a well-known time frame. So the message delivery is up and bounded with a time delta. In real world, it's somewhat unrealistic. So in actual internet, messages can be lost. We can have retries, whatever. Some messages can be very slow. We have this well-known thing called the long tail of a message delivery. And this long tail falls behind this time limit delta, and there is a problem. So second model is so-called asynchronous. This model captures all kind of environments where if somebody delivers a message, then the message is eventually, sometimes, perhaps in very long future, finally like delivered or it reaches recipient. But there are no assumptions about this time delays, how long a message is delivered. And consequence is that when we are building the protocols, we cannot have any timeouts in it because we have no assumptions about timing. So this model is quite strong. It basically automatically adapts to network environment. But at the same time, the asynchronous model is quite expensive, meaning that the number of messages exchanged per one round is usually larger than on synchronous model. And third model is perhaps more realistic, so-called partially synchronous model. it's defined so that after some unknown time, GST or global stabilization time, we are again synchronized. So this time period until GST is when things go wrong in our network, and after it, everything is fine and message delivery is again up and upper bounded with a certain delta. And in this model, always safety cannot be violated, but if things go wrong, the network is unstable, then can be a period when this protocol or algorithm doesn't make any progress. It basically halts during this period. So this is a realistic model which is like most widely used. But recently we have also seen some interesting developments where algorithms have basically two passes or two paths for execution. One is for happy times, when the messaging is synchronous, and if things go wrong, then this algorithm switches over to asynchronous mode. So this kind of like algorithms are it's a more survivable, because in partially synchronous model, if you have some number of faulty nodes, then the speed or progress like goes like really fast down. But anyways, in like practical systems, partially synchronous model is reasonably good. And finally, like really important property of a distributed algorithm, when we have fixed our expectations or assumptions about the environment, are how many malicious or failed nodes a system survives before like breaking up. And this result is different in case of synchronous or partially synchronous or asynchronous model. If we assume crash failures, nodes are not malicious, then we need that at least one node is still alive in order to execute and order messages. If we assume Byzantine failures, then of course we need to have more nodes to survive a certain number of malicious or broken nodes. And here we have also a distinction between ordering of messages and execution of messages, because the distributed system can be split into layers. First, we order transactions, and then in different layer we validate them. And there are like different assumptions on how many nodes can fail on those layers. But yeah, basically the fact is that if you are building Byzantine fault tolerant algorithms, then in general case, in a partially synchronous network, then we assume that we have Byzantine failures, meaning that we have a very strong adversary or attacker, we need to have at least three times as many nodes as can go wrong or as can be malicious. So let's say if we assume that there can be up to two malicious nodes in a system, then in total we need to have 2 × 3 + 1, it's 7 nodes to survive 2 malicious. And basically this is what applies to most of distributed systems which are Byzantine fault tolerant. Now, a couple of examples how this kind of distributed agreement protocols work. First example is Paxos, which is a fail-stop secure model, meaning that we cannot have malicious nodes. And this picture has only so-called happy path when we do not have broken nodes and we do not have to rotate or assign a different leader in a protocol. And this message has basically two steps. First, one node makes a proposal to have an agreement about, others send their acceptance. If a party who made a proposal collects enough acceptance messages, then we are locked and we can send response to client. It's quite trivial, only a couple of message road trips. But another example is simplified Byzantine fault tolerant called practical Byzantine fault tolerance, which is like basically a first well-known practical Byzantine fault tolerant consensus protocol. Here we have one more message round trip. And the main reason why we need to have it is that the leader who sends a pre-prepared message can send different messages to other parties. And that's why other parties must exchange this first pre-prepared message to each other in order to verify if there is no fooling from the leader's part. And then, if we have exchanged messages and figured out that the leader is okay, they can commit to a proposal. So being Byzantine fault tolerance introduces us some overhead. First, we need more nodes. Secondly, we need more steps in a protocol. And But this picture displays only the so-called happy path. If leader fails, we need to replace leader. It gets more complicated. And all these Byzantine fault tolerant protocols can be described in terms of how many messages we need to send to each other. And what happens if we, instead of three followers, we have 100 followers? If you look at the number of messages, then it goes totally out of hands if you have 100 nodes. But basically, we need to use more efficient protocols, which are available right now. So let's go on. And now let's talk about how to build a ledger consensus, given those basic assumptions and problem description. So first, we can build a ledger consensus protocol based on this Byzantine fault tolerant consensus algorithm. And it works using those steps. First, we elect a leader node. So we have a set of nodes, and one of them will be a so-called block proposer. And this leader node proposes a block of transactions, and all other nodes, so-called validators, validate all those transactions and reach agreement with everybody else if, yes, indeed, they are happy with particular block after validation, and if they are ready to commit it. And then after running this one instance of Byzantine fault tolerant consensus algorithm, we have a finality, meaning that there is nothing else what can go wrong and we can safely commit this block. And some relying parties can also already do something based on it, like you are buying milk, you can already like have your milk after just one this protocol instance. So second possibility is so-called using some kind of like longest chain rule. It means that again we have some kind of leader assigned, and this leader node proposes a block of transactions, and if some other node likes this set of transactions, then he can build another block on top of it by adding some other transactions into this block, and then again some another block can pick a set of transactions, validate them, and add them to the chain. And having this kind of chain means that all validators of who have produced these following blocks agree on this first block in this chain. And when the chain gets longer, then we have like more approvals, more agreements. And the more agreements we have, the stronger we can believe that all transactions in our like first blocks are valid. But yeah, the problem is that the finality is not really well defined. We can say that we can trust a block if we have five other blocks built on top of it, or 10, or 6, with some probability. But making this decision involves just accepting of some risk of non-finality. Because at the step when some other nodes build a block on top of our first block, some totally other nodes can start adding their own blocks. And it's possible that our ledger basically forks, meaning that we have like two different chains built by two different subgroups of validators. And this is solved using some rules. And of course, the most obvious rule is that we just have to pick the longest chain. But again, this is a probabilistic algorithm without strong finality. But the good property of this kind of algorithm is that we do not basically care how many nodes we have executing this algorithm. So it automatically adapts itself to changing number of nodes. And finally, there are some like sub versions of those possibilities, meaning that nodes sign everything they see. If you have like certain number of signatures, then we can assume that the block is final, or it makes sense to combine it with a longest chain rule. And also we have one class of protocols which are so-called directed acyclic graph based, meaning that we have some relaxations in total ordering of messages. We have independent forking chains, and eventually those chains are pulled together into some important, well-seen, well-witnessed nodes to give ordering to those sub-chains. So it's similar to longest chain rule, but it has like different block or transaction graph behind it, basically. And again, if we have a Byzantine fault tolerant algorithm based ledger consensus, it means that we have deterministic and reasonably fast finality. If we have a longest chain rule, it means that the algorithm is like really adaptable to nodes coming and going. And it's more flexible, but at the same time, it doesn't give us strong finality eventually. So what this is in fact quite popular ledger consensus system used by many blockchains. And one trick how to achieve finality is so-called finality gadget. It means that the nodes execute the longest chain rule, and after like a certain number of blocks added, the nodes execute an instance of the Byzantine fault tolerant algorithm on top of result. So of course it works on optimistic conditions when the number of nodes is stable. And then second is that it adds still a certain latency to the protocol. So in at this sense, it's again like automatically adapting system. In optimistic cases, we use benefits of Byzantine fault tolerance with some extra latency, but if things go wrong, then we just drop this BFT consensus layer, and still we have this longest change rule, which guarantees some progress based on arbitrary number of valid nodes. Let's move on. So every time when we are building a blockchain and this ledger consensus, there has to be some system or rule to just figure out what kind of nodes, machines, computers can participate in this algorithm. And in the case of this Byzantine fault tolerant thing, we had to have a pretty stable set of nodes participating in this those algorithm runs. In case of this longest chain rule, then usually the nodes have to do something complicated, or they have to present that they are lucky based on some kind of lottery before they are allowed to produce a block proposal. But in general, how this gatekeeping works, how the nodes are accepted to this set. So one is proof of stake. And in case of proof of stake, the participating nodes have to show that they have made their investment, they have staked a certain number of crypto assets to participate in a protocol, and basically we have a list of nodes with stakes, and somebody who haven't staked enough this crypto asset will be just thrown out of the door, and we have fixed set of nodes who participate in consensus. Or in case of this longest chain rule, we can modify the probability of a node being a leader or a node having a chance to produce a block based on the stake it has. So second possibility is delegated proof of stake, meaning that we can have some outside parties, outside investors, whatever, who delegate their stake to some professional participants in a protocol who have big machines and who again participate in this consensus. And the third one is proof of work. Whoever solves a hard problem can propose a block. So this is the oldest one, which is and this is one used in a Bitcoin network. But the proof of work is extremely expensive and slow. In order to produce a block, it's necessary to show the outside world that this node have just basically wasted some resources in order to obtain an honor of producing a block. And those resources don't have to be hard computation. It can be also like a proof that a party have given away some kind of storage, wasted this storage, or whatever things we have. So it's basically proof of waste. I would keep away from it. I love nature.
Engineer is going to be proof of wasted physical resource.
Yeah.
It can be energy, it can be disk space, it can be something else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but basically the important thing is that this hard problem must avoid the situation when lots of malicious parties can join our system without showing any effort or doing something hard. So we have to have some kind of like gatekeeping available. And next, we will talk about the consensus in as it's used in AlphaBill. Hierarchical ledger consensus, or HLG, is a name for it. So The consensus in AlphaBuild, the ledger consensus, is implemented as a layered system. We have two layers. First higher layer is so-called root chain. And the lower layer is a set of partitions. Those partitions implement different transaction systems. And those partitions can be more or consequently split up into shards for better throughput and better scalability. So one partition can have one or more shards in it, just given on throughput requirements. Let's look at how it works. So shards. Every shard maintains a subset of units or tokens. And within every shard, the number of tokens is split up into chunks or buckets of tokens, and every bucket is assigned one leader node within a shard. And then the assigned leaders produce a block proposal based on this bucket of inputs. And this block proposal is delivered to other nodes within this shard, and the other nodes, who themselves might be proposers for another bucket, validate those blocks, validate transactions, and confirm that, yeah, indeed, this bucket is produced in rightful way, all transactions are valid, and yes, they are accepted in this particular set, in this particular ordering. But the nodes in shard do not execute like actual consensus about it. Basically, a leader produces a block, others validate it, they update their internal state, and the cryptographic checksum of this state is then delivered to root chain. And then root chain, in fact, determines if there is a consensus about those proposals within every shard. So it means that there is no other communication between shard nodes than just producing a block proposal, and that's it. So root chain receives requests from shard nodes. The shard nodes also include some extra metadata to validate correct operation of a shard. We validate if all nodes extend the same previous state with their particular proposal, and they also validate that some transaction system specific parameters hold. For example, if it's AlphaBuild currency shard, then root chain validates that the total amount of money within this shard is always constant. After validating those incoming requests, root chain collectively, as a proof of stake controlled distributed machine, produces so-called unicity certificates for every individual shard and returns them to all nodes within shards. And when given on these unicity certificates, the nodes finally can see if they produced a valid block or they need to roll back from their proposal. And if it's a valid block, then they all can produce a new block and add it to their ledger. But if there's something is going wrong, then this unicity certificate works as a source of randomness and synchronization, so that shard nodes know that they need to start another block producing attempt. And yeah, the cryptographic proof which gets included into every block is produced collectively by root chain nodes. So it means that in order to produce a unicity certificate, a large majority of root chain nodes must participate, and they must agree on the validity of incoming requests from shards within partitions. So this is like a very long way how to describe it. But this picture is perhaps a bit simpler. So it's a very, very much simplified form using this PBFT specific round names. So first, client sends a transaction to a shard. Within shard, let's assume that the leader receives a transaction, it produces a block proposal and sends it directly to other validators. Everybody updates the internal state, and the cryptographic summary of this state is sent to root chain as a single compact request. So this request is basically a couple of hashes only, but the input can be lots of transactions, perhaps thousands of transactions. And when the root chain executes Byzantine fault tolerant consensus instance to find a consensus about validity of this incoming request. No, and of course, this root chain has to do some other tasks as well related to governance and node management of partitions and everything else. But still, right now, this root chain, we have see only three nodes, runs a BFT consensus instance. And after it returns unicity certificate to all nodes within a shard. And based on this unicity certificate, a shard produces a finalized block and can return it to client. So in real world, of course, there are more nodes and there are more shards involved. So this kind of like two-layer architecture, it's looks like a symbiosis. The both of those layers execute a certain number of tasks. Our root chain provides randomness to partitions within those unicity certificates, and it also sends those unicity certificates works as a messages or timing references so that partitions know that they need to restart a consensus attempt if necessary. The root chain enforces transaction system specific rules like money invariant if on currency-based partitions. It is enforcing the consensus in terms of safety, meaning that it verifies the previous state of a shard and the next state of a shard after executing a transaction and make sure that there is no possibility of a forking of a shard state. That always a certain previous state must be extended with every successful request. And also it root chain provides governance. But the partition nodes, there are lots of shards and partition nodes which provide bulk transaction validation, execution, state keeping, state replication, and also ledger or blockchain block production. So both layers do have different tasks, validation and management. And thanks to this bill-based model, it's possible to have really useful simplifications in building this kind of like layered consensus algorithm. So the sharding is easy. There is no such thing as cross-shard transactions, basically. If one unit, one token, one bill changes ownership, then only the owner's name, label is changed on this particular bill in certain ledger, but nothing else happens at other shards. It means that we do not have a problem when there is an account in one shard and account in another shard, and we need to inform our shard that the first account got debited so that other one can be credited. And this one has to do atomically, which is hard. So we don't have to solve this kind of like cross shard execution at all. And it means that during the system lifetime, if we see that one shard has too many transactions coming in, it's easy to just split one shard into two shards. We just split up the number of units or tokens. One shard manages the left half, another one manages the right half, and everything goes on as before. So no cross shard dependencies. And of course, this kind of like easier sharding, we do not have also to implement global ordering of all transactions and messaging. If transactions can be validated independently, it means that we can execute them in any order. So we do not need global ordering, which is in fact expensive thing to do on large scale. So parallel leaders within partitions, yes, because it's so easy to split the state space between nodes, it's quite trivial to split up one large block into smaller chunks, each validated and proposed by independent node. And the unicity certificate is important unique property of AlphaBuild system. It's for us a globally shared trust reference, which can be used as a source of trust for ledger proof validation. Ledger proof is a compact, small proof of transaction execution. It can be shared, it can be exported, other parties can verify it, and this unicity certificate is generated immediately when transaction is executed. So there is no waiting for some central beacon chain, for example, signing a block header. It's generated basically before a shard block is committed. And it also makes sure that partitions or shards cannot sign conflicting blocks during one round, which is a possible attack. And I would like to claim that this kind of two-level architecture solves the so-called blockchain trilemma. This blockchain trilemma is stated as it's impossible to guarantee both security, scalability, and decentralization using one system, one blockchain system. Perhaps this conjecture is valid on general case, but AlphaBuild system is built on top of this bill-based model, where every individual transaction can be verified based on local information only. And we do not need any cross-shard communication for bill validation. So it means that we can split up or shard up the validation layer into as many shards as necessary without compromising decentralization and security, but at the same time reaching any scalability level we need. So let's look individually. So security is the thing where we cannot have compromises. So the entire system is built around a very strong security model, which is enforced at every layer of a system, at the root chain, at shards, at partition level, and also on this logical system level layers, like at at the data model layer, at the consensus layer, at transaction execution layer, and so on. And by security, we do not mean what is often understood in blockchain world. So in some, I've seen that security in blockchains is defined as, let's say, hash rate on Bitcoin case, or number of nodes in blockchain. So in fact, the security is like the most important property here at all. So it's a thing where we cannot have a compromise. So the decentralization is addressed by the root chain. Root chain has a certain number of nodes. For a decent level of decentralization, it executes a delegated proof of stake consensus algorithm. And the load of this decentralized distributed machine is pretty low, because this layer does not see individual client transactions at all. It sees only some aggregate requests coming in from individual shards. So this means that the root chain does not have to solve the scalability issue, because the scalability is added by just having a large enough number of shards at lower layer. So we can say that the root chain provides us the decentralization and, of course, security, because security is the basis of all. And as said, partitions and shards provide us scalability, and also they provide security, because validation of transactions is performed at shard level, and we must perform it according to rules. But yeah, the shard level, we do not need decentralization, because the root chain executes decentralized governance for those shards. Do we have any questions about it, perhaps?
Yeah, I have a question about the staking aspect of the root chain. And that is how we've said that the root chain is based on delegated proof of stake, right? And stake is coins or value that is owned by the validator and potentially the people who have delegated to the validator.
Yeah. Or more exactly, it's a number of tokens which are locked up into some kind of like governance contract by those validators.
By the validators, right. So the information about what stake is actually delegated, which coins, how much they're worth, and so on, right? That information is located on the partitions.
I think that the partitions do not care about this kind of staking, because the root chain...
The question is, the root chain, right? At the root chain, I need to know that the votes that are being cast by the validators represent a certain amount of stake on the network. And the information that tells me who owns what, that information is on the shard, not on the root chain. So somehow that information has to get from the shard to the root chain in order to be considered, in order for the validator set to know that the current block proposer has enough stake, for example, to be the block proposer, that he's not just someone who sort of pretends to have a lot of stake. Do you see my question?
I would explain how I understand it.
Okay.
So the root chain knows a certain information about every shard. And about every shard, he knows basically a list of nodes who are members of his shard. And he knows some cryptographic parameters to authenticate messages coming in from those shards. But the list of the nodes within this every shard comes from a governance process. And the root chain is executing this governance result of this governance process by validating that the nodes within every shards are in fact coming from this list of assigned node list from this shard.
So my question is a little different, I think. I'll try to explain it better. My question is about the validator set on the root chain.
Yeah.
Right? And if you assume that the validator set on the root chain is determined by those validators having stake or having stake delegated to them, then my question is, for a given validator, how much stake do they have and how much stake is delegated to them? I need to know the answer to that question, I'm assuming. In order to conduct the consensus process at the root, I need to know who has what amounts of stake. And that information about who has what amounts of stake, though, is not actually in the state of the root chain. It's actually in the state of one of the potentially many of the partitions. So how does that information about who has what stake get from the partitions to the root chain?
So let's call this special partition as a governance partition. So it executes the governance algorithms, and it also performs accounting of staked amount of currency. And this is a special partition. Its identifier is hard-coded, and the root chain has to execute decisions made by this governance partition. So within the root chain, in simplest form, it is a leader-based consensus algorithm. And the selection or choice of who is the leader who can produce an X block, the probability of being a leader depends on the amount of stake assigned, so staked in this special governance partition. And the thing is that all other root chain nodes have access to the state of this special partition and can validate if the claim coming in from next leader that, yeah, I'm a leader, send messages to me, if it is a valid claim. So when the next leader is determined, it's a stake-weighted probability.
Right. So it sounds like in order to become a validator, you would have to put up your delegated stake, and you would have to lock that somehow on the partition where it is, or
yes,
partitions where it is,
yeah,
and then present proof that you have done that,
yes,
to this governance partition,
yes,
and then the state of how much you have put up in stake is available there, and that information is presented to the root chain.
Yes, and it's pretty static information, it doesn't change fast.
No, I understand that. I'm not thinking that we have to sort of update this in real time. This is something that could be locked up for a longer period of time, and you can just sort of evolve it very slowly, not at a high rate of value, not a high volume. Okay, thank you.
You got my attention saying no shard is talking about a shard directly.
Exactly.
You have money in shard 0, I have money in shard 1. Could you please describe how our transaction takes place and what are the steps after the transactions to get understanding how much money each of us has?
So let's say that I have a €5 bill in shard 1. In order to give it to you, I change the label attached to this €5 bill. That before it was this is mine, and after the transaction, the label at the same bill says that now it's Kaido's bill. So the bill itself doesn't travel anywhere. It's still at the same place, but it's you who has to keep track where you have your bills around in a system. So if you want to make a transaction with your bill, you have to know that it resides in partition 1. You have to send your transaction order to this shard 1, and After the next transaction, the bill remains exactly at the same place, still same machines manage it. And it's totally possible that in your wallet there are 10 bills and all the bills are handled by different partitions. And it's up to you to know where your bills are.
Different partitions or different shards?
I mean same.
So Risto, how would you describe the various attack vectors on AlphaBill versus more traditional proof of stake networks?
In fact, this is what we have on the next slide here. So the so we have a in case of proof of stake networks, there is a almost like a standard list of risks which what can happen on the so-called like first generation proof of stake blockchains. Of course, the blockchains improve and they mostly do not apply anymore. And in AlphaBill, we have specific measures taken against some, but the most of them just do not apply. But let's look at them first. So so-called grinding attack first, meaning that malicious node can somehow modify their probability of being the next leader and then gain more rewards. So at partition level, it's basically impossible that the node skips some rounds in order to be a next leader, because the signal to go to next round is based on a unicity certificate from a root chain, and here partition nodes do not have any influence. At root chain level, the probability of being the next leader again depends on amount of stake and the protocol guarantees that single nodes or minority of nodes cannot advance the system to next round. So the mechanism here is specific to the consensus algorithm. We have so-called timeout certificates, meaning that in order to advance to new round without producing a block, it's necessary to have a certificate from a majority of nodes. It looks like a quorum certificate, but saying that no, we didn't produce a block, but you can be the next leader. So next one is a nothing at stake attack, meaning that node can sign some transactions, then call back his staked money, and then later on he can unreveal something what was signed during the period when he had staked money, or he can reuse his private keys later on, or he can sell his private keys to somebody else. Definitely does not apply to AlphaBill, because it's not possible that a node signs a new block which is valid after, which are like as added or attached to a blockchain later on, because of the cryptographic links between blocks. And secondly, the possibility that the validators sell their private keys, let's say that two-thirds of validators sell their private keys to an outside attacker, and when an attacker uses it 1 year later, it's also avoided by the key management schedule. So and finally, the so-called low value attack. So this is an attack which applies to young blockchains, where the total amount of stake is like pretty small in a system, and some malicious party can just have lots of money and can buy all the tokens and can take over the system. So the question is, of course, if it's valid attack or not. Perhaps if he has, if he basically buys the system, he is rightful owner of a system. But still, if we have some kind of like foundation which does its hard work to set up the system for not actually without the reason to make lots of money out of it, it's necessary to retain some kind of control of a system. And it's very likely that at the beginning, the majority stake or some, let's say, special coins are owned and controlled by the foundation. And eventually, when the amount of staked money is like financially large enough so that nobody cannot take it over, then we can switch to like decent decentralization without any specific foundation's control. But the point here is that executing a switch to fully decentralized proof of stake network is complicated, and at the beginning the system is pretty fragile.
What other risks could we have?
Shard takeover attacks, how do you deal with those?
Yeah, of course the shard takeover, you mean that we have a pool of validators and a certain number of them is malicious. And when the root chain assigns a number of those validators to a specific shard, then the absolute majority, like more than 51% of nodes are malicious. So technically, we have many layers of safeguards here. First, of course, is that nodes are assigned randomly to partitions, but still the probability of majority being malicious is considerable. Even probability of 1 to 1 million is large enough, and it's totally possible. So in order to avoid it, at the consensus level, we need only that simple majority, like 51% of nodes is honest. But at the algorithm level, we can tune those parameters. It's possible to have a partition level security thresholds. For example, we mean that if there are 25 nodes in a partition, we define that we have to have, let's say 22 matching votes in order to move on with rounds. And just randomly getting 22 malicious nodes into one shard is probabilistically like very close to impossible. Or we can have like different rules. If we care a lot about availability, we can say that we need that 10 of 10 valid votes must overlap, and we ignore the number of total nodes within this partition. So this is just at the consensus layer, but of course we have a data model layer. We are producing blocks. Blocks is a public information. Everybody can see and validate those transactions. It's easy to implement slashing. If you see that somebody have produced or somebody have validated invalid transactions, just given the majority takeover of a partition shard. So it's many layers, and it's still ongoing work.
Thank you, Risto. What about adaptive corruption attacks, where you wait until the shard validators are assigned, and then you go to take them over?
Yeah, of course, the validators are rotated certain frequency. And secondly, we in fact are enforcing some rules, so-called equalization rule and stabilization rule. Meaning that we maintain a reputation for the nodes, and we keep nodes with good reputation in partition
short for longer. If a reputation is low, we replace them faster. So it's a rotating pool, which is controlled by governance algorithms, and those algorithms must make the probability of bad things happening low enough. And slashing.
Is slashing consistent with deterministic finality, right? So for ledger proofs, for using in smart contracts, right, you need this proof. And if that proof is not finalized, it's only probabilistic, because someone can show up with a fraud proof and then try and rewind the blockchain. So even fraud proofs just don't seem possible in a deterministic finality model like Alphabet.
Yes, at this case, this fraud proof and slashing is like a second extra layer of security when original assumptions on a system do not hold. At the consensus layer, for example, we have an assumption that at least 2/3 of root chart nodes are honest, and within every partition, at least half of the nodes are not malicious. But this slashing can still be used if those assumptions do not hold, and if you have a bigger number of malicious nodes. And same with reputation.
Transactions are—it's deterministic, it's final.
Yeah.
But people can still lose their stake or whatever. It just happens afterwards. You don't rewind the blockchain. You don't have a longest chain rule.
Yeah. This is whatever is written in blocks. This is an absolute source of truth. If you have some kind of arbitration, it has to be higher system layer. Does not happen at the blockchain level.
Nice.
But by system design, by parameters, economical parameters, we make this kind of things infeasible, let's say.
Nice.
But some other blockchains, for example, rely much more heavily on fraud proofs and slashing. By just executing transactions speculatively, we just have perhaps only one proposer who executes transaction, and the next block gets added without obtaining majority's confirmation on this block. So this provides better performance, but at the same time it gives us a risk of providing and finalizing invalid blocks. And at this case, if you have like too much optimism, then it's necessary to just take the money away of bad guys.
So I have a question about the validators on different partitions versus the validators on the root chain. It seems to me that the system requirements for running a validator node within the root chain will be different than for the partitions, and additionally, not only that, but the software that would end up being run would be different as well. Do you also anticipate that the amount of stake or the rules for staking or slashing would likewise be different for validators in the root chain as compared to the validators in the various partitions?
Yeah, I believe that the incentive system, incentive algorithms, and software and everything else is very different for root chain and partitions and shards. Even when we compare shards and partitions, then we can have different performance goals, scalability goals between shards, and one shard might require very high-end hardware in order to achieve minimal possible transaction latency. Other transaction can be slow but cheap at the same time, so we can have a diversity in terms of requirements. And within at the partition level, the most important thing is a node reputation based on past performance of transaction validation and execution. And this one prefers faster, more performant nodes in order to just those two requirements were equalization, that we have enough validators within every partition, and stabilization, that we
incentivize good validators to be online, to participate, and yeah. But the root chain has different requirements. In root chain, we need to provide decentralization. Means that it must be open to absolutely anybody to join without having some kind of reputation requirements. The only thing is that to avoid this civil attack, we need some stake. And that's it.
Okay, and so the differences in compensation for validators, you think will be related to that, those performance requirements? Because clearly if I have to buy a very expensive machine in order to participate, I'm going to require more compensation.
Absolutely.
For doing that.
And yeah, the root chain has like very good visibility on performance of every individual partition, because he sees when the requests from partitions are coming in from different nodes. He can compare who is faster, who is slower, and also the root chain can have perform statistics about liveness availability of individual nodes from individual shards. So this information is all available, and root chain can make governance decisions based on it.
So in sharded blockchains, you often hear about data availability. You know, I think it's typically because, you know, like L2s, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think they're actually just a single machine, right? They're not decentralized. And so data availability in that case is a huge issue, because it can post the results to the Ethereum main chain, but lose all the data on the L2. So does that apply to AlphaBill as well?
Yeah, and therefore one thing is, the problem is the optimism within L2s, meaning that in order to be secure, we rely on fraud proofs. So that based on proof of somebody doing something wrong, nodes are enforced to be honest and we are slashed and so on. But you cannot do slashing if you don't have proofs, and you cannot do it if you do not have information or data. So let's try to think what this data availability problem is when applied to AlphaBill system. So let's have a picture here. So all the nodes within one shard, we have like 9 of them, something like this. They cannot produce requests to root chain if they do not replicate block proposals. There is no communication of this state root hashes between those nodes. It means that in order to participate in a protocol, they all need to produce blocks, and those needs to be full blocks. So perhaps a problem with data availability comes if you are relying too much on light clients or light validators, which do not need an entire blockchain to validate everything. So it's like hard to see how it applies, because in AlphaBill the blockchain can be decomposed until we have only one unit or one token. But still, this one token can be validated based on its entire history. And if somebody cares only about one token, we can generate a cryptographic proof with all transaction history about this bill. So in this sense, I do not perhaps understand how this data availability like problem applies. Because yeah, nodes within chart, they provide this ledger replication protocol to others if a node joins a shard, and to rest of the world if they want to replicate shard blocks. Maybe because we want to act as an archive, or maybe because we want to validate arbitrary transactions. Does somebody have a good example how data availability problem applies to AlphaBill? Because I just think that it's not directly applicable.
Yeah,
Just some sort of some speculations. This is application specific question, basically. Depends what kind of problem you're solving. For instance, if you have some kind of heavy distributed application, every bill represents some kind of document that contains a lot of text, maybe some multimedia, maybe some programs, some kind of legal contract. Then probably keeping storing all of this in validator's infrastructure makes no sense. So probably you just want to reference it by hash.
Yeah, in this case, this is like totally application specific. But at the infrastructure layer, I think we can say that we do not care about data availability problem.
Yeah, absolutely. I just want to prove that basically bills follow, you know, bill state change follows some kind of rules that are encoded in predicates, and that's it.
So how alpha bill compares with ETH2 or future Ethereum? So by setup, it's quite similar. We have a beacon chain in at the place of root chain, and we have shards where we have shards in alpha bill as well. So first difference is in algorithms, what shards execute. In Ethereum, shards execute a full consensus algorithm, ledger consensus, with longest chain rule within every shard individually. And they also execute longest chain rule based consensus algorithm at their beacon chain layer. And after producing a block at a shard, this shard gets is sent to the beacon chain and included in a block. So basically the beacon chain includes block headers from other partitions into its blocks, and at the same time it executes governance. So by how we divide tasks between layers, it's quite similar, meaning that the shards validate transactions, they execute transactions, and beacon chain or root chain do governance. But how it's synchronized is like very, very different. In AlphaBill, in order to produce one block, this one block already includes root chain's approval. So there is a unicity certificate in every block produced by the root chain. And this unicity certificate, in fact, is shared between all shards, meaning that this is, works as a shared root of trust, and transactions can be immediately verified. So if we extract compact ledger proof from one shard, it can be delivered to anybody who can verify it. And of course, it happens much faster. So if you have a cross-shard transaction in Ethereum, then it means that the first produce a block in one shard via debiting an account. Then this block header gets included into the beacon chain. And then based on this beacon chain anchored proof, the recipient shard credits account. But still, because we have three steps, but the thing is not atomic because of the consensus algorithms do not have strong finality. It's based on longest chain rule, it's probabilistic. So that this is not atomic, and it takes quite a lot of time. In AlphaBill, having a transaction between any parties is just flipping a owner label of one bill or owner condition. It happens in one step, it's verifiable by everybody, it's just straightforward. And I guess this is the biggest difference.
Yeah, so there's no concept really of cross-chain settlement.
Yeah. We can have atomic transactions which happen with many bills, possibly in different shards. But still, it's two rounds of execution, and it's guaranteed to be atomic.
So, Risa, one question. You know, NEAR protocol just just recently announced some really interesting results. How would you compare it? And I guess there's many new layer ones. You know, Definity, Radix, NEAR protocol. That all do sharding. What's the significant difference between Alphabet and those?
Okay. When I would better compare with NEAR protocol to Ethereum. Meaning that in the NEAR protocol is very much optimized towards optimistic execution, where a sharding model is like very close to what Ethereum has. We have consensus within shards. It's a longest chain rule based. Again, we have beacon chain, so that if it's necessary to have a cross shard transaction, it's necessary to have transaction in one shard, when beacon chain approves it or signs the block header, and when another account is credited. But when comparing with Ethereum, I guess that NEAR protocol is more focusing on so-called happy path of execution. We are more relying on just single one validator proposing a block, and we are relying heavily on slashing if this single optimistically trusted leader or validator misbehaves. Ethereum is a bit more pragmatic. It runs like actual longest chain rule consensus algorithm with stronger guarantees, I guess.
Presumably, they're more focused on sort of decentralized applications, right, as opposed to a global settlement layer, right? If you just have a small application, sort of Definity style in canisters, right? Yeah. You're not so worried in that case about cross-shard transactions because you're running a web service and people are interacting with that. You may not need that level of scalability with settlement finality.
Yes, this appears that it's more like an execution platform, yeah. Or a way how to have, store bills. It's more about storing currency and less about transacting with a currency.
Do I have one more question?
Please, go ahead.
So Avalanche, it looks quite similar also to Avalanche and Avalanche's subnets. How would you describe the difference between Alphabet and Avalanche subnets?
I remember something about this Avalanche's algorithm. So it's involved some random subsampling of different nodes and figuring out if they are at the same opinion about the global state and if we have like a large enough number or ratio of positive on converging samples about global state when our nodes are in agreement. This is a very probabilistic algorithm. I think it survives with lesser number of malicious nodes, because this random sampling can go like really wrong if you have already perhaps like 20% of malicious nodes. And regarding the data model, I think they are account based. So at this terms,
yeah, I think Avalanche uses, you know, it has its main use case is the EVM in a subnet. I think the challenge they face is when that subnet fills up and it gets congested, what do you do? Because you cannot shard that subnet, So do they create another subnet with another EVM chain in it? And then how do they do cross-shard transactions between those? So I think it has challenges.
Yeah, perhaps we saw cross-shard transactions or smart contract verification, if it depends on information in our shards, is like very, very challenging, let's say.